Apollo Players present Tell Tales, a series of monologues written and performed by members of the Apollo Theatre Company. The Duchess of Argyle, written and directed by Chris Hicks, with Fiona Gwinnett as the Baroness.
For reasons which will soon become apparent, I'm not going to tell you my name or business. It's likely you'll get the wrong impression of me. And besides, I don't know if I can trust you with such sensitive information. So, for the purposes of this narrative, you may call me Baroness. That will do for now. Baroness Marguerite de Chevalier, to give you her full title. She's an alter ego, you see? One of a number I employ from time to time when the need arises. I found her particularly useful over the past few months. It's extraordinary how much respect one commands with a title, no matter how bogus. You see, I am a natural performer. I love all the accoutrements of theatre, props, makeup, costume, all the paraphernalia of the stage. You can be who you want, go where you like, behave as you please when you're dressed for the part. As someone once said, all the world's a stage. All I require is an audience. Now, the Baroness is my invention. A pinch of Garbo, a dash of Dietrich, and, if I'm honest, a fairly generous helping of Margaret Rutherford. I use her occasionally when I want to make a splash, which was exactly my intention last Friday, when I visited the Grand Metropole Hotel, just off Fleet Street. You may have read about it in the papers. I arrived just after 10. The place was busy, as you would expect at that time of day. People checking out, others arriving, wealthy tourists rubbing shoulders with the cream of London society. No one noticed mousy little me as I mingled with the crowd. I slipped up the side stairs and into an empty room on the first floor, hanging a do not disturb on the door, and quickly adopting my disguise. Wig, lipstick, eyeliner, 6-inch heels, and a glorious cloud of orange chiffon, which I picked up at Oxfam earlier this year. There's nothing quite like big hair and bling to make an impact. It's funny how clothes give you confidence. The Baroness simply takes over when I'm wearing her things. She's such a brash, extrovert woman, so much more outgoing than I could ever be. As soon as I was ready, I went back down the main stairs and straight to the front desk in order to complain about the shower in my suite. And there are few things as vexing as a noisy complainer, and once she gets into her stride, Marguerite is one of the worst. I soon had the whole lobby in my thrall. Of course, the poor man behind the desk couldn't work out who I was or which room I was supposed to be staying in. But that's of no consequence. I had everyone's attention, and that was all I required. Then, just as things were reaching a climax and I could see the concierge was about to intervene, I performed my pièce de résistance, a little trick I learned in my misspent youth. Flouncing away in a fit of righteous indignation, I turned and went arse over apex down the steps to the lower hall. People came running to my assistance just as you'd expect, gathering up the contents of my handbag, which had spilled all over the polished marble floor, and helping me to my feet. I hobbled to a chair. I do a very good hobble, and somebody got me a glass of water just as the fire alarm went off and we all had to leave the building. Mission accomplished. I have to confess I was rather pleased when I saw that our little escapade featured in the national press 2 days later. Only a couple of paragraphs in the Mirror, but it's better than nothing. Up until recently, we've only been mentioned in the local papers. I've begun to keep a scrapbook. Press cuttings, news reports, that sort of thing. Partly for practical reasons, but if I'm honest, it's mainly about vanity. I may not be on the London stage, but I still like my performances to be appreciated. I suppose it's the nearest thing I'll ever get to a theatrical review. Mind you, the latest photo fit wasn't exactly flattering. It aged me by at least 10 years. Oh, anyway, that's beside the point. As I'm sure you've already realised, I can't afford to be too well known. Much as I crave the limelight, fame is just one tiny step away from notoriety, and I can certainly do without that. Now, before I carry on, I suppose I'd better explain why I was there in the first place. You see, my husband and I had stayed at the Metropole for the first time last month. We'd come to London to see a show and stopped over for a couple of nights, as we sometimes do. It's like a mini holiday. Does us the world of good, and it often provides an opportunity to do a bit of reconnaissance. Always good to combine business with pleasure. In the past, we used to stay at the Grove, but I've got to say it's gone downhill a bit recently. We weren't that impressed the last time we stayed, which is why we decided to try something new. Never a bad thing, in my opinion. Well, our first trip to the Metropole turned out to be something of a revelation. It's a splendid place, to be sure. We never stint on that sort of thing. But nothing prepared us for what we saw on the first floor landing when we arrived. I remember we were following the porter up the main stairs, and as I looked up, I saw this face smiling down over his shoulder. So beautiful. I glanced across at my husband and could see by his expression that he'd noticed her too. "Well," I said when we were alone in our room, "what do you think?" I could hardly contain my excitement. Of course, he wouldn't commit to anything until he could be quite certain. But that's typical of him. Always keeps his cards close to his chest. "Oh, come on," I said, "I'd know that face anywhere. She's the genuine article, I'm certain." On the way back down to dinner, he managed to have a closer look without drawing attention to himself. My suspicions were confirmed. The brushwork was exquisite, the detail sublime. That evening, we drank champagne with our meal. After all, it isn't every day you find a genuine Gainsborough on your hotel wall. Quite what it was doing there, God alone knows. I mean, it's really the sort of thing you'd only expect to see in a museum or stately home. But, as I've said, the Metropole, it is a cut above the rest. So, there you have it. We returned exactly a week later, incognito. You see, my husband and I have always appreciated the finer things in life. We have what you might call expensive tastes, which is a bit inconvenient if you only have a limited income. Art, literature, wine, travel. Life would be a very bland stew without these things to spice up. Nothing seasons the broth better than a well-planned heist, when everything falls neatly into place. So, now you know. We are thieves, plain and simple, like a pair of little jackdaws. We simply can't resist the temptation. There are lots of ways of tackling a job, but in our experience, simplicity is always the best approach. We stick to easy targets. Museums and bank vaults are more or less out of the question, and we never work for profit. That's asking for trouble. It invariably attracts unwanted attention. And besides, we enjoy the challenge. It's certainly more than a hobby, but if I'm honest, it wouldn't be half so much fun if we had to do it for a living. The trick is easy. We've played it on a number of occasions. No one sees what the left hand is doing if they're busy watching the right. All you need is a sharp knife, a steady hand, and a bit of distraction, which, as I'm sure you've already realised, is where I come in. So, while I created mayhem in the hall below, my darling husband cut the Duchess of Argyle from her frame and had her neatly rolled up in his umbrella in less than 20 seconds. Then, invisible amongst the crowd, he set off the fire alarm and made his way out into the February sunshine. I popped into the ladies at the station next door and emerged moments later with the Baroness all wrapped up in my shopping bag, ready for another day. Met up at a cafe 2 streets away. Early lunch, glass of wine, a bit of mutual gloating. There's nothing quite like it for putting a spring in your step. The sense of elation, of shared excitement. And, to be quite frank, it's done wonders for things in the bedroom. Shared transgression is a wonderful aphrodisiac. And as I said, the Baroness is only one of my creations. These days, my darling husband's never quite sure who he'll be sharing his bed with next.